A very good morning to all the participants, esteemed Vice Chancellor of Sambalpur University and all other dignitaries, particularly esteemed Professor Ishan Patra, Madam Madhumita Das, the Vice Chancellor of Pokhran University and the Ravensa University, of course. Today is the 12th day of our lecture series, the webinar. Before I introduce our honorable speaker today, our own Vice Chancellor, Professor Deepak Kumar Behera, I would like to introduce the team members who have worked day and night over a period of 15 days to make this program a successful program one. And before again I start introducing them, I would like that the participants should keep their microphone mute and turn off the camera during the talk. And anybody joining during the process are requested not to mark as present now button, because that disrupts the discussion, the presentation process. And I'll also request the participants to please ask the questions in brief and put it in the chat box, mentioning your name, your definition and affiliation. These questions will be taken up by the moderator and will be put before the speaker to respond. Now, as I said, that we have a group of members who have actually worked to make this program happen. Although the main architect behind this entire show is our own Vice Chancellor, but by virtue of his habit, he does not come to the front. He only says that all others should be in the front, and therefore I would start with the members. We have with us the team members include the chairman, Postgraduate Council, Professor A.K. Das Mahapatra. I am the one. Professor Biswajit Satpathy, the convener of NAAC. The director of IQAC, Professor Golu Maharana. Professor Sanjay Kumar Sahu. Professor Ashok Mahapatra. Dr. Sanjay Kumar Patnaik, the Deputy Coordinator of NAAC. Dr. Nihar Satpathy, the Director, Sambalpur University Institute of Information Technology. Dr. Hirak Chakravarti, Assistant Coordinator of NAAC. Our Deputy Registrar, Mr. S.P. Raut. Dr. Rajiv Padi, the Development Officer of the University. Dr. Chandrasekhar Panda, the head of the Department of Computer Science and Application. Mr. Atul Nag, Assistant Professor of SUIT, and our System Engineer, Subrat Kaur. Now, as I said, our inspiration is the today's speaker himself, Professor Deepak Kumar Behera, the Vice Chancellor of Sambalpur University. With these words, I once again welcome every participant, all distinguished participants and the research scholars and teachers of the university and other institutions who have been invited to join us. I take also the privilege to introduce our speaker, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Sambalpur University, Professor Deepak Kumar Behera. Deepak Barbera has completed successfully a Vice Chancellor of Burhampur University before becoming the Vice Chancellor of Sambalpur University. And it is with his leadership that Burhampur University has been accredited with grade A by NAC. Professor Behra is a social anthropologist by training, having specialized in the areas of tribal studies and children and childhood. He was a full-time professor in the Department of Anthropology, Sambalpur University, for more than 16 years before becoming the Vice Chancellor of Burhampur University. Professor Behra was a Fulbright visiting lecturer at California State University at Long Beach. In 2007-8, he was a dead guest professor at the Department of Social Anthropology at Carl Eberhard University of Tübingen. In the year 2013, he was also visiting professor at Aarhus University, Denmark, in 2011, University of Free State, Bloemfontein, South Africa, in 2001, University of Durban, Westville, Durban, in 2003, South Africa, 2002, Federal University of Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, in 2004, and Maison Bees, Science de la Homme, Paris, and CNRS, ESS, Toblaus, in 2006. He was the recipient of Carlos Chagó Foundation Fellowship, Brazil, National Research Foundation Fellowship, Republic of South Africa, German Research Council, Germany, European Union Fellowship, Indo-French Fellowship, ICSSR, Indo-Israel Fellowship, UGC, and so on. Professor Behra has, to his credit, more than 18 books and edited volumes and over 125 research articles. Of those volumes, he has brought about 10 volumes of contemporary society tribal studies in association with Professor George Pfeiffer of Free University of Berlin, Germany. He has successfully completed more than a dozen research projects funded by UGC, ICSSR, Ministry of Welfare, Winner Rock, International Sastri Foundation, WHO, German Research Council, and so forth. 24 scholars have already been awarded PhD degree and one D.Litt under his supervision. Professor Behra has gone abroad 40 times, visiting more than 30 countries in different academic capacities. Professor Behra was elected as member of the Executive Council of World Anthropological Association, the apex anthropological body at the international level, in the year 1998, and served that position for two consecutive terms for the period 1998 to 2008. He is the founding chairman of the International Commission on Children, Youth and Childhood. As the chairperson of the International Commission, he has already organized more than a dozen panels and sessions relating to children and youth in different international conferences and symposia. Both Sambalpur University and Burhampur University signed more than half a dozen MOUs with overseas universities under his leadership. With his initiative, a batch of students from Sambalpur University went to different European universities for a semester under the Erasmus Mundus. He was a member of the Governing Council of Association of Indian Universities, New Delhi, for three consecutive years, 2013 to 2016. Professor Behra is in the executive board of the Center for India Study at Aarhus University, Denmark. He was the managing editor of the Journal of Social Sciences, New Delhi, during 1997 to 2003. He was a member of the advisory committee of ICSSR ERC Kolkata for more than 6 years. He has already served as the chairman of the Nagpur team on several occasions. In recognition of his outstanding contribution in the field of social anthropology in India, Professor Behra was awarded with the prestigious Sarat Chandra Roy Memorial Gold Medal by Asiatic Society, Kolkata, in the year 2017. So much indeed for an enormously impressive profile of Professor Behra. He is the last speaker of the online series, and he will address university and college teachers and research scholars to hone their academic skills, to be innovative in their teaching methods. And his topic of deliberation today will be how to be academically skilled and innovative, some points to ponder. With these words, I welcome our speaker today, Professor Deepak Kumar Behra sir, and at the same time welcome all the participants and distinguished vice chancellors of other universities who have been always associated with us over this 12 days period. Now I hand over it to our speaker, Professor Deepak Kumar Behra.
Thank you very much. All the participants and our revered participants, I take this opportunity of presenting my lecture, online lecture, and you know the title that has already been announced by our chairman, postgraduate council. So this title is very simple. My presentation is how to be academically skilled and innovative. Some points to ponder, but I would like to add some points for the young teachers to ponder. How you hone your academic skill and be innovative. That's the title of my presentation. And somewhere in passing, our chairman, postgraduate council, mentioned that I am a social anthropologist by training. And we social anthropologists believe in micro-level analysis, and our methods are like storytelling, personal narratives, and experience sharing. So as we move on, I will adhere to those anthropological methods. And now, you have heard many stimulating presentation, excellent presentation, and many times what happen, you listen, enjoy, and then appreciate, then you remember some points, and then you forget. But today, is a different type of day. As I said, I would be dealing with micro-level situation. Today, you hear and you make self-retrospection. So every time, I show a slide, you ask, am I? And the other question that you ask, do I do? So now let me, take you to my, I have a slide, PowerPoint presentation. Initially, I decided that I will just speak from my heart. That's my preferred mode. But now I have a PowerPoint and so just a minute, there is some technical problem. Yes. So as you can see, how to be academically skilled and innovative, some points to ponder. Now, before I go into my lecture, I would like to show you three important quotes, one by a very famous cultural anthropologist from United States, Margaret Mead. And she said that child must be learned how to learn and not what to learn, quote unquote, how. The child must be taught how to learn and not what to learn. And second one by Benjamin Franklin, tell me, I forget. Teach me, I remember. Involve me, I learn. See the last one you see, involve me, I learn. And the third one by Clay P. Bedford. And this is also a very interesting quote. You can teach a student a lesson for the day, but if you teach him to learn by curiosity, he will continue the learning process as long as he lives. So these three, you know, quotes are the foundation of my lecture. And now I will take you to micro level. So, you know, let us do a stock taking, you know. I will ask each one of you, not to our revered vice chancellor and senior professor, but junior teachers and research scholar, if they have pen and a sheet of paper, that would be interesting. We'll play a game. So you all want to be, you know, successful teacher. So please, you know, try to rediscover yourself. There is a natural tendency. If I have strength, I want to project it. If I have weaknesses, I try to hide it. If there are opportunities, I may avail it or I may miss it. When there are challenges in life, I may accept it or I may fear to face those challenges in life. So this is the process of rediscovering yourself. So please try to rediscover yourself, you know. I'm asking you to rediscover yourself. So now, you know, what do I do after the rediscovery? Okay, so you please identify, you know, your weakness. Prepare a list, your weakness as a teacher. And this is very, very important, you know, stock taking, self-retrospection and assessment. And then convert those weakness to strength. Okay. And then also you identify major challenges in your teaching profession. There are many, you know, you call that problems. I would like to call them challenges. So identify those major challenges in your teaching careers. And again, you know, convert those challenges into opportunities. This is what, you know, what do I do? I said, you know, every time you ask, am I or what do I do? Okay. So now this is after self-rediscovery, you must follow this chart, you know, what I'm showing you. Now, so I'm going to show you some checklist. Not coming. Yes. Checklist with some test indicator. Okay. Because this is self-assessment, self-learning. So for each checklist, there will be some test indicator. And you evaluate yourself. I said, you know, it is all about assessment. We believe in micro level analysis. I'm not, you know, taking you to macro level. Are you a successful teacher? Are you an innovator? How good you are in terms of leadership? So be honest while making self-assessment. That is the tip I would like to offer you. And this is a, you know, experiential process of learning. You learn by yourself, you know, as a teacher, as a research scholar. So are you a successful teacher? There are 12 test indicators. You can see I have all ERs in one side. You will find 8 ER, all, you know, words ending with ER, 8 in number, and 4 OR, you know. So like this, you know, 12 TI, learner, speaker, listener. Are you a good learner, good speaker, good listener, good reader, good analyzer, sympathizer, hard worker? So you make assessment, you know, maybe somewhere lacking. So we can cheat anyone and everyone, but we can't cheat our conscience. So conscience will give you the correct answer. Where do I stand in terms of this test indicator? Are you a good motivator, moderator, counselor, innovator? Small thing, but small is big. I always tell my student. Okay, so you make assessment and then see, I have written two words in capital letter. One is leader and the other one is innovator. Because again, those are very, very important qualities of teacher. So next slide is on innovator. Again, there are some test indicators. There are 10 test indicators. It's not coming. So this test indicator are, do you do things differently? Number one, do you value diversity? Do you collaborate to bring innovation? Do you try to move away from conventional wisdom? Okay, do you have inherent curiosity that motivates you? Next one, do you have infectious passion, passion that fuels the innovative fire? Do you have the courage to keep fighting? Not with your boss. I mean, courage to fight with the adverse situation. That's what I'm referring to. How often do you challenge or ignite student mind? How frequently do you use network to mobilize resources? Do you always involve your student in learning process? So test indicator, there are 10 test indicator, and you make assessment and try to find out where do I stand in terms of this 10 test indicator. Okay, so definitely you will find that maybe some area where you are lacking, and you please note it down. And there is enough scope, room for improvement, believe me. Then, as I said, you know, I showed you in the penultimate slide, two words written in all capital letter. One was, innovation. It was innovator, and the other one was leader. So then the next question, are you a successful leader? Again, 14 tips. It's all about leadership quality. Leader must be honest. He should have sense of humor. He should be confident. He should be committed. He's a man with positive thinking. And he is intuitive, reliable. He stays focused. He's a respectable person. He has a lot of passion, you know, and he is loyal to the group and loyal to the institution wherever he is. And he's a courageous person, he's optimistic and open-minded. So these are 14 test indicators. So the question is, are you a successful leader in terms of this 14 test indicator? These are small things. But again, these are very, very important things, because we always try to project our strength and never make a correct type of assessment. So I have given you three sets of indicators. First one was relating to teacher. Are you a successful teacher? Second set of indicators were relating to innovator. Am I a successful innovator? And am I a successful leader? Now, these are three sets. And again, for leadership also, you know, you can see, you just take the first alphabet of the sixth bullet, then you find leader, L-E-A-D-E-R, you know, all printed in blue letter. Lead by example. Leader is one who lead by, again, 6-T-I, six test indicator. One who leads by example, he is enthusiastic, amiable, determined, encourage student, and ready to learn from his mistake. He is a leader. So again, you do a stock taking, go for a self-assessment, and you see, where do you stand? Do I have all these qualities to be a successful teacher? So am I academically skilled? Only when you are academically skilled, you can be innovative. Now you look at this person, you know. I'm showing you a list of person: Henry Ford, Bill Gates, Disney, Einstein, Darwin, Newton, Edison, Lincoln, Chaplin, And then Indian, you know, Shahrukh Khan, Sachin Tendulkar, Amitabh Bachchan, Dhirubhai Ambani, APJ Abdul Kalam, Rajinikanth, all these people failed and failed miserably at the first attempt. For instance, I would tell you two, three from this side and maybe all from Indian side. Henry Ford, you know, he failed 5 times before he founded the successful Ford Motor Company. 5 times, not 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times he failed before establishing Ford Motor Company. Bill Gates was a dropout from Harvard, you know, started a failed business. Now he is a multimillionaire. And Walt Disney, fired by a newspaper editor because he lacked imagination, had no good idea. Many of his early business ended with failure and bankruptcy. See, Albert Einstein doesn't speak until he was 4, didn't read until he was 7, causing the parents and teachers to think that he was mentally impaired, handicapped. Charles Darwin, you see, left a medical career. He was often chastened by his father for being lazy and too dreamy. Thomas Edison, teacher, too stupid to learn anything, fired from his first 2 jobs for not being productive. Abraham Lincoln went to a war as a captain. After his return, he started numerous failed business, defeated on numerous occasions. Charles Darwin, his act was initially rejected by the studio chief because he felt that it was a little too nonsensical to ever sell. And it was rejected because of his overacting. And you know, Shahrukh Khan, he was sleeping on the footpath and he was, you know, asking his friend to give some money, 10 rupees, 20 rupees to visit Film City. And he was doing that on a regular basis. Sachin Tendulkar, you know, he failed at 800 and he was banged by his parents. So he left home for a day. That happened to Sachin Tendulkar. Amitabh Bachchan, he was rejected by AR because of his heavy voice. Dhirubhai Ambani, you know, he was serving in a petrol pump. And APJ Abdul Kalam, he was rejected in his first interview for the position of a pilot. Rajinikanth, he was a bus conductor till he attained the age 30. So that is how, you know, you see the title, failure is the pillar of success. Never give up. Try to learn from your own mistake. When you analyze your mistake, that turns into experience. And that experience will lead you to success. Keep on trying. Stay positive. You know, what is most important? Attitude that matters. So now, you know, I will take you to my next slide. See, here A is equal to 1, B is equal to 2, like that X is equal to 25 and Z is equal to 25. So now we'll see, skill is equal to 82. Knowledge is 96. Hard work is 98. So what makes 100%? What makes 100%? Attitude. Attitude that matters, you know. We learned that from the previous slide. So never accept defeat, you know. Keep on trying. So it's very, very important to have a good attitude, positive attitude. Okay. Now, do I have, as I have said, you know, do I have, do I do, am I? These are the questions you have to ask. Do I have? I can do attitude. I can do everything, but not all at once. I can do everything if it is important enough for me to do. I can do everything, but I may not be the best of everything. I can do everything, but there will be limitation. I can do everything, but I will need help. So this is very attitude. Many times you have complaining attitude. No, I can't do it. That's not my business. So ask somebody else to do. These are my problems. But see, you can have this kind of attitude if you want to be a successful teacher, innovator, and leader. So I will say a very famous quote, and this maybe you will feel motivated. Our life and behavior are reflection of our attitude. Attitude, not aptitude, that determines our altitude. The positive thinkers see the invisible, feels the intangible, and achieve the impossible. Whether a glass is full or half empty depends on the attitude of the person looking at it. If I have a positive attitude, I will say the glass is half full. And otherwise, if someone has a negative attitude, he would describe it the other, just the other way around. There is always a better way for everything. Find it. A positive attitude is not destination, you know. It's a way of life for a teacher. So, therefore, the difference between a successful person and others is not lack of knowledge, but it is lack of positive attitude. Okay. So now, you see, I have highlighted one word here, that is successful. Now, I will take you to that area where, again, you have to make self-assessment. So all the time you have to make self-assessment, and I will tell you small things. Not very, you know, hi-fi thing, small thing. Do you want to be successful? Obviously, it's not interactive platform right now for the moment. So the obvious answer is yes. Then the next question, what are the parameter of success? Okay, you want to be successful. The parameter of success is skill. I borrowed this idea. I know I love reading Birat Serenia. So I borrowed some idea from him. Acknowledgement always good. Categories of skill, you know. If I ask you, what are the skill? You will say this skill, that skill. But if you classify them, all skill, you will find two categories. Domain knowledge and soft skill. Okay. Now, in what proportion do you require them? There was a study by Stanford University, and they came out with interesting result. They asked several people, you know, and this is what was their finding. Domain knowledge 70%, soft skills 30% in teaching profession, and non-teaching profession you require more of soft skill, 85% soft skill, and domain knowledge 15%. So finally, when we train our student, where do they go? All of them never, you know, join teaching line. So you'll find majority of your student in non-teaching profession, and you see how much of domain knowledge they require, 15%. So these are something, you know, you must examine and analyze, and accordingly, you know, you plan, make your teaching plan. So reason for losing job, you know, in teaching, 40% people lose job because they don't have skill. They don't know how to teach. They don't know, you know, they lack expression, body language, gesture. Those are not good. And 60% because they are not knowledgeable, you know, teacher. That is why they are fired. And non-teaching, you see, lack of soft skill. So you'll be hired and you'll be fired if you don't have soft skill. Lack of domain knowledge, 20%. So what are then soft skill? Your communication skill, leadership skill, passion, perseverance, teamwork, concentration, empathy, motivation building, stress management, decision making, expressing idea, how you relate yourself to people, even time management, working under pressure. Now you ask yourself, you know, do I have this soft skill? Because only when I have this soft skill, I can be innovative. Do I have this soft skill? Now checklist, again, this is a checklist. There are many test indicators, and you examine where do you stand in terms of this soft skill. Are you good in everything? Maybe anger management is one, what is like stress management. So when you are an angry person, so you are not quite productive, you know. So how do you manage your stress? At that point of time, you shouldn't speak. So these are soft skills, you know, and you should be a quick learner, because you are all teacher, you are innovator. So you should be quick learner. If you are lacking some of this soft skill, try to have, you know, this soft skill at the earliest. Now, I would like to take you to the traditional teaching in Indian university. Time, effort, money, all spent in acquiring domain knowledge. So students spend everything. Of course, they don't spend money. Money is being spent by their parents, especially the father. But time, effort, definitely they spend. And there is hardly any attention paid to soft skill in our, you know, traditional teaching. When I look at myself, I was never given any training on soft skill. So even, you know, that was the case 5-10 years back. Recent time, okay, we have started putting emphasis on soft skill. And now, the next question is that how much do I know about human mind, my mind? Do I know how to deal with my mind, human mind? The question I'm asking, you ask yourself, do I have that technique that I control my mind? So this is a very interesting question. And you see, the tendency of human mind, the more I resist, the more it persists. If I say that today is my lecture, okay, let me not feel nervous, I'll start feeling nervous. Okay, let's play a game. Close your eyes and open your eyes game. So I request all the participants to close their eyes. Or they can think anything, everything in this world, excepting their beloved mother, living or dead. So don't think about your beloved mother. Open your eye. So what did you see? Mother, mother, mother. So this is typical tendency of the mind. The more you resist, the more it persists. Now, the question is then, so where does soft skill originate? So it originates, whether you can have soft skill by training or it originates from human mind. Yes, it originates from human mind. Innovation, lack of innovation, human mind. Leadership, concentration, lack of concentration again, human mind. Confidence, lack of confidence, human mind. Passion, decision-making ability. Everything, you know, each one of this originates from human mind. Now the question, did I receive any training, coaching to control my mind? Not in school, not in college, not in workplace. It makes the process of living so simple. It helps a person to be a good human being. So, but you see the plight, you know. I have never been trained in school, college, workplace, but it is very important to have that kind of training. So when you discipline your mind, what are the outcomes? It gives you inner peace and outer dynamism. Inner peace you require to be a good teacher, and you require outer dynamism, you know, to be a successful leader and innovator. So that is why it's very, very important. But you know, how do I discipline my mind? Training through meditation. I'm talking about a different kind of meditation. I don't say that you go to the Himalayas, don't grow beard, don't make renunciation. I'm talking about a meditation that will help you to develop concentration and that will help you to stay cool. Developing concentration, keeping your cool. And that kind of meditation which makes your life holistic. And you can connect different aspects of your life. So this is very, very important, you know. So we never think about this. So only when I have a stable mind, when I'm cool, when I have concentration, I will be innovative and productive. So I'm trying to develop a chain of thoughts. It's not my thought, as I said. It's a borrowed idea from Virat Sirnia. Success skill, skill mind, mind meditation. Okay, this is a chain of thought. And you try to figure in, you know, and you try to do a kind of self-inspection. Then, you know, there, I have said you several thing. And the most important skill is in teaching profession is communication. Am I fully satisfied with my communication skill? Two questions. That is, you ask to yourself, how often do I try to improve the communication skill of my student? Because if you want to survive in teaching profession, that's the most essential skill. So now let me take you to one area, essential of good communication skill or presentation. So when you make presentation, you are communicating ideas and information to a group. Remember, the group may be your student, the group may be a professional, you know, group of professional in a conference seminar. So presentation reflects the speaker personality and allow interaction between all participants. So please remember, a good presentation has content, structure, and human elements. So all the three are very important. So remember, when you speak, your body communicates different signal to the audience. Student not only listen to you, they also watch you. Okay. Throughout your presentation, you have to display eye contact, facial expression, gesture, posture, and body orientation, proximity. Maybe you have to move around, and if there is a big room, and speak to them. It's not good to sit on the chair and teach the student. So then I come to the voice. You know, this is very, very important. The voice is probably the most valuable tool of the presenter. It carries most of content that the audience take away. If you have got a good voice, that is very, very important. And voice, your volume, your tone, and the pace. You should not move too fast, and it should not be very dominating tone, and the volume, it should be, you have to, make a judgment how loudly you should speak. If it is a small room, don't speak very loudly. So the voice is again important. Use visual aids wherever it is necessary. So I don't say that all the time. Professor Osok Das doesn't like this kind of using high techs. So, but this is what I'm showing you, three things. How to take information during a presentation. So only text 7%, visual 55%, vocal 38%. But when you use bullet points, it is 33 and visual slide 67. And you see bullet points and visual slides. So making presentation memorable. So you achieve your goal in terms of the second one. So when there is necessary, please use visual aid. And you must remember, active listening is different from hearing and passive listening. Good speaker not only inform their audience, they also listen to them. You should be a good listener. I have already, said in one of my slides. So active listening is not the same as hearing. Hearing is the first part and consists of perception of sound. You get a perception of sound. And listening, that is second part, that involves cognitive processing of the oral symbol. So passive listening occurs when the receiver has little motivation to listen to you carefully. That happens many times in the classroom. Without our knowledge, we think that students are listening, but they are hearing you, and that may be passive listening. Active listening with a purpose is to learn. So only when your student will do active listening, they will hear. They will learn. Here, you also evaluate the classroom situation. So what happens in a classroom situation? Many times your student look blank because they are hearing you. They are passive listener and they are not active listener. So the main enemy of a presenter is tension, which ruins the voice, posture, and spontaneity. First, do not fight with nerves. I have already said, welcome them. If you welcome nerves, the presentation becomes challenge. Okay, you accept the challenge and you become more effective. So So tension can be reduced by performing relaxation exercise. You can take a deep breath and you can release the air, then you feel relaxed. There are so many, you know, tension releasing exercise. So the art of handling question, you know, many times you feel very annoyed if someone raises a question. Keep cool if someone disagree with you. You are a professional, no matter how hard you try, not everyone in the audience will agree with you. Please remember. So question do not mean that you have not explained the topic correctly. And you know, that doesn't mean when some audience, some participant may have deeper interest than the average audience, that's why they are raising question. So always allow a time at the end of the presentation of question. So don't leave the room suddenly, you know, because they need time to articulate their thoughts and put your question. So give them some time. And, you know, when a question is asked, you know, in not proper manner, maybe you reframe the question and then, okay, do you mean to say this? And you raise this question. And then you raise this question to everyone, you know. So, and then while answering, you know, your answer should be short, so that you can take more number of question, and you try to reinforce your answer to the main topic of your presentation. So you relate it while answering the question. So these are the art of handling question and important tips. If you have handouts, don't read the handouts straight. Speak to the audience, not to the visual. Then because your points become pointless and you are without power. Sometimes I said that your PowerPoint said bullet points, your PowerPoint said points without power. So eye contacts and your gesture posture, that scope you don't get in a platform like this. But those are very important in a classroom situation. Speak clearly and loudly enough for all to hear you. And you should be a good listener, you know, listen to the comments and question. Move around the room as you speak. Vary your techniques. Remember, it's better to finish slightly early than to overrun. So these are some, you know, then important question, some tips and, you know, because that those are your personal learning. And how do you do with regard to your student? How often do I conduct personal interview and GD in a classroom? Do I teach my student how to make sensible and effective PowerPoint presentation? Because wherever they go, you know, it's they have to face personal interview, GD, they have to make a PowerPoint. But we think that, see, I'm not a soft skill trainer. Why should I teach them? That's not my business. See, as a teacher, you are a multifaceted personality and you have to do multitasking. So a, you know, soft skill trainer may not be able to do that. You know the course content and you know everything. So you are the right person to handle those kind of question. So you should teach them, you know, how to, you know, for example, you know, these are some questions. You tell them how to answer this question. Tell us something about yourself. Whenever they face, your student face any interview, why do you want to work in our organization? What are your strengths? What are your weakness? Who is your role model? I may say my role model is Tendulkar. How many century Tendulkar has scored? I don't know. So, you know, you train them. And you train them. These are the questions they will face wherever they go. What are your career goals? Why should we appoint you? Tell us what you know about our organization. What are your salary requirements? What would you like to see? Where would you like to see yourself 10 years down the line? See, if you prepare them this 10 question, you are, you know, giving them an input which will help them to fetch a job from the competitive market. But we never teach them. We only teach them pedagogy, and that is why they are like bookworms, and they feel, even if they are knowledgeable person, they are not employable because they lack this kind of skill. Similarly, how to make a PowerPoint. I'm not going to this, you know, tips, because I will go to my last slide and my, sorry, you know, this personal narratives, you know, these are very, very important. And, you know, before describing this, I would like to give you some tips. The first one is you develop reading habits as teacher. Those are not there in my PowerPoint presentation. And when they come to your first class, tell them about the scope of the subject, small thing, and about the history of the department, university and local eminent personality. Then introduce the paper. It is never done. I didn't do that when I was a teacher, I tell you frankly. So you have to take it very seriously. Introduce the paper. What are the objectives? Expected outcome. They should know. Inform the student the nature of the study. Student should also get study material. I would like to share my experience of United States. So it's unpleasant experience. I was teaching a group of graduates in the Department of Human Development. On the first day, they asked me, Prof, what is the course spec? I said, what is that? No, you are going to deliver 31 lectures. We should get all the 31 lectures on the... So it was a nightmare for me, like a normal Indian professor. I prepared 17 lectures. I thought that I would be getting time to prepare the remaining lectures. But that was the expectation of the student, that on the first day, they expected all 31 lectures from me. Then second day, they asked me, Prof, you have not given us your schedule. I said, what is that? No, you must tell us on what day you are going to teach what, so that we'll come prepared. And so the classroom would be interactive. I was taken by surprise. Then I prepared, okay, I will give it to you. Give me 2 days' time. See, unpleasant experience I'm sharing. And then said that, Prof, you are not seen in the beach board. That was in Long Beach. I said, how come they're inviting me? I was confused, What is this beach board concept? Then said, Prof, we have registered, you are not coming to that beach board and you are not posting your material. So how can we learn? And then said, there is a counseling component also. We don't have counseling component. Why I'm sharing this thing? Maybe that is a kind of experiential learning. So they said, all students, boys and girls, they will come and they share their some disturbed student and they would share their experience and you have to give them counseling. So always you can say, I'm not a trained applied psychologist. Why should I do it? No, that's your job. You have to train, you have to give counseling to your student. So those kind of realizations are very, very important. So that happened to me. And then, I would also bring in one point here that they said that innovative teaching, that there was a component. So what I showed them a movie, documentary movie of NIRD, Lost Childhood. I was handling a paper, Children and Childhood in South Asia, special reference to India. So I showed them that movie and they were given two opportunities to watch the movie, then critical thinking, So I framed some question and they were given the question and they answered. And they enjoyed, And student presentations are very, very important. That I will come later on. So when you introduce the paper, you give them the source book on the very first day, maybe study material. We never do that. What are the textbook? What are the reference books? What are the open surface? On the first day, you have to inform your student. And you give them also orientation on the choice-based credit system. Okay, they are used to that. How the grade is being calculated, how there is a non-negotiable academic calendar, what is the exam schedule. See, small thing, but these are also important. Then organize a walk tour. Take them to library. Okay, if you have a friend from library information science department, invite him. So tell them how one will refer, like the author's index, subject index. Take them to different sections, journal section, textbook section, reference section. They feel refreshed, They develop a group identity that we are one. They feel happy. So they don't want to always be in the four walls of a room. So this is a very good kind of exercise. And then also do a stock taking. So that you should do at the beginning. Their academic background, their socioeconomic background, the previous educational background, medium of instruction, whether they are slow learner, average learner, advanced learner. This you must judge at the beginning. And help them, as I said, you know, to learn soft skill. Then you said, you know, the course is so fast. How can I accommodate, you know? You draw a calendar. That's very, very important. We never draw a calendar. And involve student. So fit in different things, you know, going out and doing, you know, something in a group, like group activities. All these things can be, you know, built into the program. And you design a calendar, involve student, you know. Involving student is very, very important. Only then they will learn. And maybe you show them a PPT on a PowerPoint presentation on a PowerPoint. Teach them how to appear personal interview, group discussion. You know, those are like the lifeline. If you don't teach them, then only they will be bookworm. And then give them, assign them topic of seminar presentation. Seminar presentation is very, very important. And I am reminded of my experience of Carl Ebrard, you know, University of Tübingen, where, you know, you have to, of 90 minutes, the student will make a presentation of 30, 40 minutes. So you play the role of facilitator. You prepare the student. The student will come to you 3-4 times. You prepare, and then that student will teach. You introduce the topic. The student will teach. And at the end also, there will be question answer session. The student will answer, student teacher. And when he will fail to or she will fail to answer, you do the rescue job. So how, you know, when they pass out, they are already half teacher. Of course, in our country, in our state, it is difficult. But you can do that with one student, you know, a student who has got good communication skill and student who is advanced learner. You can convert him to a student teacher. And you help him, help her, and she or he would deliver the lecture. And when that student lecture would deliver, the student would be more attentive and receptive. So those kind of experimentation doesn't require any cost. You can do it at your level. And so you must be a teacher who should communicate difficult things in a simplified manner. But what normally we do, if you feel, if I'm you know, teaching at a lower level, I will be underrated by my students. So we go to the higher level. And that is the normal tendency, you know. Why should I teach at the middle level or lower level? No. No, a question of my rating. But, you know, your lecture will go over their head. Please, you know, judge the level where you require to make the communication. Otherwise, you are a utter failure, total failure. Please remember it. What I'm saying may not sound good. So why the students will not come up to a level? No. They can't come, you know. They have come from very poor economic background. They have been taught in Odia language. And you expect them to be Einstein and Shakespeare. That's not going to happen, my dear friend. Please remember it. So it's very, very important to come down to their level and make communication. So all the time, you should maintain ethical standard, equity and gender, you know, neutrality. And, you know, your assessment, we say midterm. That's not a good term. There should be concurrent evaluation. You divide that midterm into small examination and concurrent evaluation. You evaluate them and give them the feedback so they will improve upon. And when you feel that the curriculum requires some kind of reframing, at undergraduate level difficult, you are a postgraduate teacher, you can always, you may be a member of the board or you can advise that to your, you know, head of the department or chair of the board of studies, and give suggestion, tell why it is necessary, one component why it is necessary to be included. You say that is not my job, that is the job of the head of the department and chairman. No. You must play your role, otherwise, you know, you will be answerable. And, you know, we anthropologists believe in storytelling method and experience sharing method. Now, what exactly that I'm going to do? So I would like to tell you my story, what happened when my professor challenged me, ignite my mind. Then I was a young student in the Department of Anthropology and Sociology. So he said, you know, I was unmindful, you know, I was keeping long hair and, you know, I was wearing a wristband. Then I had a bell-bot paint, and you know, and I was keeping my cricket ball on my beside me. So I was a science student. I had botany honors. So I represented under 21. I represented my state. I didn't play. I was in the reserve. So I thought that probably if I put little more effort, I would be able to play for my state Ranji Trophy. With that intention, I switch over to, you know, this new subject where there was no practical. On the first day, so I was unattentive, inattentive, and I was peeping through the window. And suddenly that came to the notice of my professor. He said, "You lanky fellow, stand up." He asked all my history, geography. I, you know, with great difficulty, I narrated something. He said, "See, I can tell you one thing. This subject is beyond your reach. Don't waste your time. Come to my chamber. I would be very happy to issue college living certificate." This is horrifying experience. I am narrating to motivate my youngster. And then I accepted that challenge. I went back. I broke my cricket bat into pieces. My mother was happy, about to distribute sweets. And my sisters were also very, you know, nervous. What this man is doing? But that was a U-turn in my life. I never looked back. I shifted 5 principle, cricketing principle, to academics. And that paid me the dividend. In cricket, you have to do hard work. You have to have a lot of concentration. You know, you should be a confident person. And you should believe in teamwork. Okay. And you should be courageous. You are prepared to take risk. And that I shifted from cricket to academics. And you believe me, let me not boast myself. And I have taught students all over the globe properly in different continents, excepting Antarctica. How did that happen? Because a young mind was challenged by the professor. And I love my professor. And if you become a Gurudroi, that is the end of your academic career, I tell you. So now he said, "Did I tell you, Deepak, like that?" No, I keep on scolding. I might have done that. I don't remember. But you see, he challenged one young student. And I feel that because of that challenge, today I am a student vice chancellor. Because I took it seriously. You see, sometimes you have to challenge your student mind. And tell them how to move on and learn. And so sometimes show them documentary. I showed you about great personality, you know. Show them documentary movie. They are interested, you know. Then tell them, okay, we'll do something together. And take them to a community. So community engagement is also important. So everything you have to do, you have to frame, you have to build a calendar. All these things would come in. And so tell them about JRF and NET examination. Okay, because everybody, you know, wants to appear that examination after master degree. On the very first class, you motivate them. You appear JRF and NET examination and give them the syllabi, discuss a little bit about that. If they are interested to competitive, you also tell them how to appear competitive examination. So then you also divide them into groups and frame, you know, make practical arrangements where the advanced learner will shoulder up the responsibility of imparting teaching to the, or they will make them learn the slow learner, you know. They will take some slow learner, and there, you know, they will get opportunity to develop this leadership quality. What normally I do, when I see a student, you know, disturbing my class, I make him monitor. Now, you know, the monitor job is to ensure discipline, you know. That is how you have to put right man in right place in right time. This you will not find in any book, you know. I'm reminded of another experience, because we anthropologists believe in storytelling and narrating experiences, which would be, you know, which may ignite a young teacher. So what happened in my memory of Barampur University, what happened, you know, we were preparing for NAC and a few students came, "Sir, we'd see how you are going to get A grade." Then I said, "No, don't think that you would get A grade and go back to Sambalpur University." I said, come, sit. Then I offered them a glass of water. I said, "Okay, if we get A grade, that will be reflected on your certificate." And I came empty-handed, and I would go back to Sambalpur empty-handed. "So what do you think? Should you try, or we should try for B or C grade? Tell me." "No, sir. Are you going to write that?" "Yes, we'll write that." So what do you do, sir? You have to shoulder up the responsibility. You tell me, how can I support you? You won't believe, all stakeholders, teacher, student, research scholar, everyone came and cooperated me. And it was a Herculean task, daunting task, and we made it possible. And it was ready, you know, we became the fastest university to secure A grade by NAC Bengaluru. So it didn't happen, you know, just by chance. It happened because of a teamwork. So please, you know, build the teamwork among the students. They can play a miracle. You have to just analyze their energy, you know, unutilize energy in the right direction, and they can play a miracle. So again, you know, you also tell them, you know, how to, you share your experiences. Now, when they listen to you, you know, they feel motivated. If you lecture them, you know, they will say, okay, that's a lecture, just lecture. Lecture is for the sake of lecture, I have to do differently. And they think all the time about grade, rank, and all. They are not interested to hear your lecture. But when you share your personal experience, they are very interested. Your experience of failure and how, you know, how you made up the ground, and then provide them, you know, now our students are not reading original books. What I do, you know, we have a WhatsApp group, and this, many of my research scholars are listening to me. I would like to refer the WhatsApp group every day. Now, even today, I post something early in the morning, and all of them respond. They said, sir, you are giving us guidance. So you see, the relation, student-teacher relation doesn't end after the teacher, the student passes out from the department. It's a emotional attachment, what Professor Das was telling. So built in that kind of relationship, and every time they also post, and I try to learn. So it's a kind of, you know, learning from each other. The student will learn from you, and you will learn from your student. So that kind of bonding is required. And now our students are coming from a very poor background, and many of them have been taught in Odia language. So think of a bridge course, you know, where you invite a student from English department. Like here we have one, you know, gent, Professor Mahapatra. So invite him, and he would, you know, just impart teaching on basic and communication skill. Maybe, you know, you invite a person from statistics department, and he will teach, you know, quantitative techniques. So likewise, you know, you have to explore different channels. And when they hear to a new teacher, they take more interest in listening to the new teacher, because you are an old face, and every day you are going and, you know, and dumping their mind with, you know, facts which they don't require. So this kind of experimentation, tell them to also read newspaper and watch one English news channel. What? Deepak sir is boring. He is speaking very simple thing, and this is a Google Meet platform where we have a lot of expectation. And this gentleman is coming and speaking very simple thing. But I tell you, I am not those who are very advanced in the profession. My lecture is not meant for them. I am speaking to those young teachers and scholar, you know, why, how they can, you know, build a career, teaching career. And then also, you did a SWOT analysis. You can, you know, play the same game. You ask your student to find out their weakness and challenges, and they, once they identify, and you help them how to work on those challenges. And you know, you engage, you know, there should be some kind of productive engagement. If you do it regularly, productive engagement, give them a problem, and develop their problem solving attitude, and that is very, very important for you. Sometime, you know, you tell them to prepare things in group. While dividing them, distributing, how I will form my group, I tell you. I noticed that one student is a very good communicator, advanced learner. One is computer savvy. One has a leadership quality. I will form a group. So those three students can form a group. And now they can make a PowerPoint presentation. So other two students, they don't have the ability to make a presentation. And if you force them, they will disappear from your classroom. Don't do that. But form a group. So there is a group teamwork, you know. That's, many times our students are very brilliant, but they don't know how to operate in a group. Again, I would like to tell a story, my fieldwork experience. So we take our student to the field work. I did it 20 times, more than 20 times in my career. And it's a month long, you know, rigorous, intensive, camp-based field work. So student work, and we do things in group. Even teachers are not spared. They would be engaged in cooking, and we walk long distance. So sometimes when we feel tired, I also sing with them. Hum honge kamyab, hum honge kamyab ek din. Oh, man mein hai vishwas, pura hai vishwas, hum honge kamyab ek din. I shall overcome. If you sing this song, you know, they feel motivated. Yes, our teacher is with us. And then they exhibit teamwork. You give them work and they do brilliant things, better things than we, the so-called adult. Because sometimes we have a tendency, teacher, we feel them as not yet knowing, not yet competent. But believe me, they are competent. They are competent than you and me. And you should not treat them irrational. You know, they are quite rational. They are quite competent. And they are knowledgeable person. Don't underestimate your student. You should be a good learner also. And I think we have another good presentation. I'm checking, you know, I have written lot many points, but this self-study, I will touch upon another point and maybe I will conclude. And we have another presentation. We'll make you learn how to not only be a participant in webinar, how to organize a webinar. This tip we are going to give. Knowledge represents, dissemination is the best part. So don't leave. Once my lecture is over, don't leave. Please stay and learn the techniques so that you can be an organizer, you can be a good leader. So what I'm saying, there is a follow-up program. We'll give you demonstration how to organize a webinar by yourself. You know, you, as an individual teacher, you can do that. So coming back to self-study. Now, this has been introduced by our government. Our higher education department is playing miracles, and we have updated our course curriculum now. You challenge the mind again, the self-study, how that is to be done. You provide them some tips. What are the, you know, books? Sometime in the name of study, we recommend 10 books, textbook, 10 reference book, and open sources 20. The student is confused, you know. Small is big and big is small. This is my conviction, because I'm anthropologist. We believe in micro-level analysis, storytelling. We don't have we are not very structured, you know. We speak from our heart. You might have seen that my friend, the other day, Professor Somendra Patnaik also spoke from his heart. So these are very important. Study, you know, self-study, how I will, you know, guide them. You play the role of facilitator, involve them. Then only they will learn. So I have a lot many points, and if you are interested, I will post all 30-40 points I have listed. And one more thing I would like to say. Even see, if you are a teacher, so sometimes what I notice in a small department, there is a lot of infightings among the teacher. So they don't pull in, they speak against each other, and students are very careful. They watch you, you know. They watch you and they adjudicate what kind of personality you are. We never also allow them to interact with other teachers. This is a very sorry state of affairs. But what happened in our university, I would like to tell a story. I'm a storyteller. So when I joined, we noticed that more than 2 lakhs pending certificates are there. So one day I invited some of the senior faculty, said, so I would like to do that work. In fact, my predecessor had already begun the work. I said, this is most challenging. So would you kindly lend me your cooperation? Everyone, you know, agreed. And we worked in a group, all teachers, you know. And you have to come up a level. If it is the interest of the university, if interest of the college, you may have difference of opinion, but that should not be reflected at that level. You won't believe our teachers worked, you know, taking away their shirt, wearing just the banyan, and with professing, we worked, and now we have cleared all our backlog certificates. Why I'm saying this? Just to make them feel motivated. You know, this has happened, and I'm, believe me, you ask any teacher in the university, he would, certify what I'm saying. So this is how you have to, this is also what we are doing. So I floated the idea, I requested my team, and they lended support, and they translated my dreams into reality. So with this, I would like to conclude. And thank you very much for your patienceful hearing. I'm not sure whether my lecture went over your head, but I'm sure some of the junior teachers and research scholar must have got the meaning element, and I'm not sure. I will get the feedback. Now I would like to request, please don't leave, give us 15 more minutes. This is a humble request by the organizer of the program. Don't leave. You know, I see 150, 60 people there. So don't leave. Be on the Google platform. And this is something very interesting, better than, I assure you, it would be 1,000 times better than my lecture. Stay back and listen to what we are presenting. Over to Atul Naik and his team. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, everyone. So this will be a brief presentation of how we actually organized this entire webinar. I have a very small presentation. Let me just bring it up on the screen. Okay, so I have titled my presentation as Online Meeting and Streaming. As we began this particular webinar, we faced a challenge of choosing between different platforms. As you know, because of the COVID-19 situation, all around in the different educational institutions around the world, people have moved on from basic classrooms into online mode of teaching. And if you remember, in India, most of the discussion that was moving around online meeting emerged around the time where people started talking about the Zoom platform. Zoom is again still, people are using it, but at some point of time, there was some advisory by the government, and people started looking for other alternatives. And so, keeping that in view, when we started this particular webinar, we thought that we would use Google Meet platform. And so, briefly, what I'll do is I'll just talk about how to use Google Meet. Even though I believe after 12 days of lectures, all the participants would have had a good practice over how to use this, but still, I'll be giving you a brief advisory about that. And apart from that, I'll also talk briefly about how to go about streaming this. So, as you know, that some of our lectures are also being streamed on the Facebook Live platform. Let me tell you that for our team, this was a learning experience. Every day we learned new things, and hopefully I'll try to talk about a few things as we go along. So I have titled my presentation in this particular order. I'll just talk about Google Meet, and then we'll move into the second part, that is live streaming. So when we talk about Google Meet, if you see what it is, it's actually a premium video conferencing product. So I want to highlight the term premium in the sense Google actually made the customers pay for this particular Meet. But because of the COVID-19 situation, currently it is available to all Gmail users till September 30th. And if you go down to their website, I have shared the link also, that they are enforcing a free limit of 60 minutes. You can organize a meeting of 60 minutes of 100 users, but they are not enforcing the time limit. But then the 100 users limit is still there. And if you see most of the, alternative to Zoom, we have Google Meet, which is now being used by a lot of different universities. And if you see, Google Meet is a part of the G Suite for Education. So G Suite actually stands for Google Suite. And so Google has a set of software packages that they provide for business institutions, for educational institutions, and then we have the normal whatever we use, the Gmail and all. So the Google Meet platform was already provided for the G Suite. So many people, when they had to move on to the online teaching, they actually migrated to the Google Meet platform. So at least for Sambalpur University, we have the G Suite for Education. Even at the institution that I belong to, SUIIT, we also have the G Suite for Education. So what you can do is you can ask your system administrator to enable this meet along with the recording facility, as well as you can ask them to enable the streaming cost. And please remember, the G Suite for education is actually free. I'm in no way propagating Google, but then this is some sort of advertisement anyways. And just passing, I should also mention there is also an alternative software that is available from Microsoft. This is called as Microsoft Teams. So you have an alternative to go for Google Suite for education, or you can go for Microsoft Teams. So both of them are currently free, and for educational institutions, you should probably explore how to do that. So let me start off talking about how to go about Google Meet. All of you are probably accessing this particular webinar through a link that is being sent via your Gmail. So we are starting this particular meeting. We sent you a mail, and then you can start this meeting. But then, so in the situation where you want to start an impromptu meeting, or in the sense you decide that, you know, you call up some of your friends, and then, you know, you want a meeting or any official meeting that can be done. So Google has now provided us the facility to add Google Meet. You can launch Google Meet straight from the Gmail platform itself. So if you can see on the screen as well, you can. I have put up a small picture over there. You can see below all your inbox and different categories of your email, you can see a small section called Meet. And it has two options. It has an option to start a meeting, as well as to join a meeting. So straight away from your Gmail platform also, you can start a meeting, and you can invite others to participate in this meeting. As well as what you can do is you can join this particular meeting as well. So after this, what we have is another way you can schedule a video meeting is through Google Calendar. Now, Google Calendar, as you can see, you can use it for scheduling various meetings to do a lot of things. So what you can do is you can click on the Create button, and then you can add details like the events, you can add guests, okay? And there is an option for adding conferencing. And by clicking on conferencing, you can add the Google Meet link, as well as you can enable live streaming in that particular location. Now, I'll tell you one advantage of scheduling a Google Meet instead of, you know, starting it off from the Gmail platform itself. Now, the Google Meet through calendar, when you schedule it through a calendar, it allows you to enter guests. Allows you to enter a guest list. And the advantage is all the users who are on the guest lists can directly enter into the meeting. Now, the problem you will see is that if you're trying to sign up from a different email and all, so the organizers who have started the meeting, they'll help to admit you into the meeting. Whereas if you are on the calendar, you can directly, the guests can directly come in over there into the meeting. But there could be some problems. Initially, when we were organizing this webinar, we faced a situation where there were a lot of almost 800 emails we had to send out. And for the first 2 days, it went well. But then on the third day, then we had a situation where we could not send out the mail. So you will have to look into how much the Google allows you to send, how many guests into that particular location. Or there could be one thing is you could allow the resource persons to, you could add them to the Google Calendar. And then from the meeting, you could send out the information for others to join in. So this was about how do you schedule a meeting, and then how do you join a meeting. So there are four different ways. One is you can directly go to your Gmail, click on the join option, and then enter the meeting code. So maybe someone shares you the meeting code on the WhatsApp or something. So you can copy that code and enter into the meeting. And those users who are added onto the calendar, so they have the option of clicking on the link directly in the calendar itself. So by clicking on the calendar itself, they can join the particular meet. Another way to join the meet is by going to the Google Meet website, that is meet.google.com, and then entering the meeting code over there. One point probably I should highlight over here is If you are using Google Meet on a laptop, you do not need to install any other special app. Now, that is something that is one advantage that I think Google Meet has over Zoom or over Skype or for that matter, other softwares. Even though Google Microsoft Teams allows you access on the web browser itself. And the final way you can join the Meet is through the mobile app, that is the Google Meet app. You can do that. So before we move on, this is some pointers how we can manage the Meet. I believe all of you are watching this meeting on the Google Meet platform. It's very redundant, but then I'll just point out few things in case you do not know. So if you can see on the lower corner, you can see there is an option where it tells you about what meeting this is. So when you are looking at this particular meeting, it says L12. So you can just click on that. It shows you the meeting information. You want to pass it on to other people, you can copy that and pass it on to other people. Besides that, you have three buttons, and this is very essential. We have been asking the participants, you know, to mute your microphone and all. A lot of people are confused about that part. So the first icon that you see is actually the microphone. So usually, whenever there is a meeting, the participant should mute their microphone, and one by one, probably the people can speak over there. Next, we have the end, leave the meeting, and then we have the camera off and on option over there. And beside that, we also have a captions button in the picture that I'm showing. Probably we do not have that, but then we also have the option to put on captions. So whenever this user is speaking in English, we actually have a caption coming up. So maybe if the connection is not good, you can put on your captions and try to follow whatever is being done. And then the last one that you see is present now option. So all of these are present at the bottom corner of the Google Meet. So you can click on present now to present your screen or present a particular PowerPoint and stuff like that. And apart from that, if you see on the sidebar, we have an option to click on peoples. You can have a list of all the peoples who are participating over there. And the organizers have the privilege to, you know, mute the participants and remove the participants if need be. You also have the option of chat. So you can chat over here as well. And probably the chat also allows you to send some files and things like that. So this was a brief discussion about how you could use Google Meet, and probably all of you are using it. So this is somewhat redundant, but then it could be good for those who are looking it for the first time. So quickly, let me talk about how we are doing the Facebook live streaming as well. Now, this is divided into two parts. So probably if you have your Facebook page, if you have your own Facebook page, so what you can do is you go to the Facebook Live. So you will see that in the option, we'll have a live option. Okay, so you can click on the live option, and then there are two options: to go live immediately and then to schedule a particular live. So what we have done is to schedule a particular live event. And when we are scheduling the particular live event, we enter the time and topic and maybe a poster image, so which will be used in our announcement post. So those who are of us who are following me, this program on the Facebook, you will see that in the previous day, we are having an announcement page which says that Sambalpur University is about to go live. And you know, you can have an option to get a reminder over there. Now, the technical part that is involved over here is when you are scheduling this, you have something called a screen key that comes over here, so which is very important for us. So we click on and copy the screen key. And what we do is we use a special software called OBS Studio. Now, OBS Studio stands for Open Broadcaster Software, which is an open source software. You need not pay anything extra. It can be installed in Linux, Microsoft, Windows, in all of these platforms. And this is where we actually are going to do the streaming. So whenever you set it up, there is a small auto configuration wizard that goes on, and when you run that, it asks you various aspects like what should be the resolution, what should be the bit rate, and other things. And there, this is where you need to paste the stream key that you've copied from YouTube Live. You can also, the same procedure can also be done for Facebook and YouTube. So either way, it is the same. And after that, you have an option of choosing between streaming and recording. So now this OBS Studio is a software that you can use for both streaming and recording, or both at the same time. as well. So currently we are using the streaming option. So from the Google Meet, we are now streaming to Facebook Live using this particular software over there. And again, it's very important to set up our audio devices from where will the sound come. So usually in a laptop, you have a mic and then desktop audio. So make sure that your mic is off and only the desktop audio is on. And you can try to get the sound from that particular audio device. Then comes the video sources. So usually because Google Meet is running on a browser, so what we do is we try to stream it from a browser itself. So the OBS Studio has an option called Sources where we choose the particular window where the Google Meet is running. And so we have the video as well as the audio. And then we click on Start Streaming. And that's where you can do it. Now, the Facebook Live gives us, when if you have done an announcement post, it allows you to start streaming 10 minutes before so that you make sure that your streaming is going on. And then if everything is fine, you go live, it shows you a small countdown, and it allows you to go live over here. So I think I tried to cover a lot within a short period of time, and this does take us a lot of time over here. If you do have any problems, I have put in the sources over here as well. So you can refer to the various sources that I put up. I refer to some of the articles of Google Meet, and then the best place where you can get details about Google Meet is through the Google Meet Training and Help. This is a very good resource. And then for Facebook Live, you can go to the Facebook Live and see the various options. And then finally, you also have the OBS Studio Wiki. It's a wiki page which you can use to actually go through what the various options. The OBS Studio is very powerful. You could use it for a lot of different things. And then finally, if you want to do some video editing, you can also use this open source software called OpenShot Studio as well. So this is all that I have to say. These are some of the softwares that we were using behind the scene throughout this particular webinar. I hope this is this has been helpful to all of you. And thank you to our Vice Chancellor for giving me this particular opportunity and our entire team who have helped us throughout this journey of our 12 days. Thank you.
Thanks. There is no time, but maybe a couple of questions if have will be very appreciated. So over to Professor Mahapatra.
Today's session, which was the last session, Professor Behra made a wonderful presentation, which was not just valuable from a practical point of view, but also very lively, especially because it was made through a personal narrative. It never sounded dull or pedestrian, sir, much to your fear. Everybody enjoyed it. And throughout your presentation, you gave a very clear and loud message to one and all, not to give up, not to throw up arms in despair. And one would indeed do well to remember a few lines from Tennyson's Ulysses, that which we are, one equal temper of heroics made weak by time and fate, to strive, to seek, and not to yield. So this message has been well taken, sir, and your speech was very inspiring as well as inspirational. And it urges us to be introspective, self-probing, and to be analytical. Thank you once again. And we have questions. In fact, the first one with a compliment also from Professor Ashok Das, who has been very kind and supportive and encouraging to us. And he has complimented you on your wonderful presentation, although he has a question and a very, very, very useful one, very, very thoughtful one, as usual of him. Can you comment on why this is not happening in Odisha, since whereas in the nearby institutions like NISA, National Law in University do it regularly, this kind of motivational talk? Why isn't this happening in universities? This is a question to you, sir.
Could you kindly come again? First part.
Why? Whatever you did today, why isn't that happening on a regular basis?
Thanks, Professor Das, for raising this question. I don't know, I mean, I keep on doing that, you know. Recently, Orissa State Open University organized some online courses, and Professor Mahapatra invited me to be a speaker. And there was shortage of resource person, and I volunteered myself, and I took probably 10 or 11 classes, and I love teaching, you know, and so I inspired those students, and all of them got the certificate. But I must extend my heartfelt thanks to our Vice Chancellor, Honorable Vice Chancellor, Orissa State Open University. And those students were from different background. So when you have a very diversity in the classroom situation, you enjoy your teaching better than that. And I keep on telling, you know, in my department, I do that. And I don't know if it is not happening in other university, but it should happen. This is my answer. Okay. In private university, they do organize a lot of this kind of motivational lecture. In fact, I have very good collection, maybe 300, 400, this motivational kind of, now video you cannot, it cannot be screened. There is a limitation, Google Meet platform. So I keep on showing those films, documentary movie. So that has been part of my teaching, and I make them learn, my student, I make them learn through this high tech. Sometimes they also call me high tech professor, but normally I love teaching with a chalk and talk method, like you, Professor Das.
May I ask
one question?
Professor Behra, sir, you raised the most interesting concept of student teacher, and yeah, student researcher can be added to it.
Yes, yes, sir.
Talking about it. Yeah, now, yeah, my issue is, this does not happen in Odisha State Universities, that we start creating student teachers and student researchers.
Yes, sir. See, there is always shortage of hands, you know. When it is question of human resource, we see some kind of, you know, shortage of manpower. But this is an innovative idea, you know. I have tried them, you know. Believe me, when I teach and when a student teacher or research scholar teacher would teach, there is a difference. Because I'm reminded of a three-fold classification. Again, a story. We are good storyteller. My professor says that, no, lecturer are chitkaraka. You know, they come prepared and they shout. And reader are like udgaraka. They vomit. Whatever they have read, they would vomit. So they don't prepare much. And professors are like futkaraka. They would give some reference. Okay, you refer. But now you see the, you go down one level, you know. Lecturer are, they really prepared well. And if you give that assignment to a student or research scholar, they would take the job more seriously and they would deliver. But believe me, they would deliver. I've tried that in my own class. But you have to be very selective. Right man in right place, I said. You select an advanced learner with good communication skill, and you play the role of facilitator. I'm sure he will do a fine job. There is no doubt about it. And we should keep on trying. Thank you very much for appreciating this point.
Thank you.
Due to dearth of time, sir, perhaps we'll take last question. And this is a very specific one. Is there any significance of integrity in leadership? Please throw light on this, since, according to your mapping, integrity scores 133.
Yeah, I mean, integrity is very, very important. And see, teachers are seen as, you know, role model. I'm reminded again, you know, I'm a storyteller. I'm reminded of my daughter. And my daughter, when she was studying in seventh standard, she would show me her script. And I said, this is wrong. How do you know? This has been written by my teacher. Are you more knowledgeable than my teacher? Don't. You can't touch it, you know. This has been written by my teacher. So our student accept us as role model. And if we fail to have those human virtues like honesty, integrity, and then if you are not ethical, if you are partial, then, you know, your student, you know, you can't demand respect. You know, respect is something which comes from within. So they watch and they judge who is what. We may pretend, but their very good, their assessment always remain correct. So I don't have to prove that I am a man of integrity. I don't have to prove that I am disciplined and, I am ethical or I am a good human being. So my student will give me the certificate. If I, you know, beat around the bush and if I shout and say that, see, here is a man who is honest and who is a man of integrity. So those are tall claim, you know. So those certificates, when you receive from the student, you feel very motivated and inspired. So our you know, role model, our role as a, you know, leader, this should be inbuilt process. Unless until you are a man of integrity, honesty, you can't lead from the front. So that is my answer to this question. And we are sorry because we have overrun the time. Somewhere in a slide I said that we should be before the time. We should not overrun, and I am committing the same blunder, but with folded palm, I beg apology to everyone. And you people are so decent and nice, particularly all the participants and all our landed vice chancellor. They have been following this program, you know, and we feel inspired. I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks to my teammates, you know. So they have done everything. And, please give a big round of applause. And now with this word, I would like to, because this meeting is chaired by our, you know, chairman postgraduate council, I would request him to propose a vote of thanks very quickly, maybe within a minute or so. Thank you very much.
Sir, thank you very much for this wonderful lecture. This is the 12th and the last in the series. I was just witnessing some of the feedback which was actually coming, and that shows the effect of your lecture. It is so impactful that it is just not that it has ignited the young teachers and the research scholars, but I feel this lecture was, as even though it was primarily intended for the young teachers, but I think young and senior teachers have many things to learn and many things to drive home. So on behalf of the team members, on behalf of Sambalpur University, and on my own, I express my sincere thanks to you, Professor Deepak Kumar Behera, sir, the Vice Chancellor of Sambalpur University, that you ultimately became just not the main architect behind this scene, but also the last speaker of this series. And we know that time is extremely limited for us, so I will not elaborate much on this. I once again thank you as the speaker, and also my sincere thanks to you, Professor Behera, as the guiding force behind the entire episode of 12 days exercise. I also thank all the participants, including the distinguished participants like Professor Ashok Kumar Das, Professor Ishan Patra, and other vice chancellors of the state universities, public funded universities here in Odisha. And I can see also from the profile, there are many from outside the Odisha who have even got the link and have joined and have educated, learned, as well as encouraged us. I thank every one of you for joining this program and having made this program a success. Thank you so much.